China-Wielding the Economic Clout by Shri V. Srinivas, IAS, and he is also the author of an important book, India's Relations with the International Monetary Fund. We welcome him here for this lecture. And in order to chair this lecture, we have Lieutenant General retired S.L. Narasimhan, PVSM, AVSM, VSM, and Director General Center for Contemporary Chinese Studies, New Delhi. We welcome him also, and we are honored that he has accepted this invitation for chairing the lecture. And I welcome all members of the audience who have found time this afternoon to be present here. Without any further delay now, may I request Shri V. Srinivas to deliver his lecture.
I'll do that. I'll just introduce you and then ask you. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's a privilege to be here in the in this place again for one of the sessions that we generally have here. I just want to introduce Mr. Srinivas, and then I'll request him to deliver the talk, and thereafter then I'll make a few remarks and then open the floor for further questions. Mr. V. Srinivas is the Additional Secretary to the Government of India and the Ministry of Personnel, Public Grievances and Pensions. He was the advisor to Executive Director in the International Monetary Fund from 2003 to 2006. He served as Private Secretary to the Finance Minister of India from 2002 to 2003 and Private Secretary to the External Affairs Minister of India 2001 to 2002. He served as Deputy Director, Administration, AIIMS, New Delhi from 2014 to 17, Joint Secretary in the Ministry of Textiles and Ministry of Culture, and as Director General, National Archives of India. Mr. V. Srinivas was the Chairman of the Board of Revenue for Rajasthan and Chairman of the Rajasthan Tax Board from 2017 to 2018. In the state government, he has served as Secretary to Government in the Departments of Planning, Family Welfare, and Science and Technology, and also as Mission Director, National Rural Health Mission. In 2017, he was awarded the Indian Council of World Affairs Book Research Fellowship for India's relations with International Monetary Fund 1991 to 2016, 25 years in perspective. His second book, Towards a New India, India's Welfare State Programs 2014 to 19, is under publication with Konark Publishers. He has delivered 28 orations and published 114 papers. He is a senior administrator, a respected academician, and an institutional builder for par excellence. Now I'll request Mr. Srinivas to deliver his talk.
Respected General Narasimhan, Chairman of the session, Shri Mishra, Deputy Director, NMML, ladies and gentlemen, my work on China with this kind of intensity and focus commenced when Dr. Duvir Subbarao, who was a former governor of the Reserve Bank of India, said that it's important that Indian bureaucrats and academicians understand the developments in China, given the pace at which the nation has transformed itself. So, as part of my book research, I undertook a study and wrote a chapter on the rise of China in the international monetary system. I also tried to understand what went behind this economic miracle in transforming China from a low-income country to the economic giant that it has become today. Subsequently, my work carried on into a number of papers on China, including their currency management practices, the manner in which they're wielding economic clout across the globe, also with regard to the new institutions that they're setting up, like the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, the New Development Bank, and the dynamics and the future scenarios that China's growth holds for the world economy and for a liberal world order. So today's paper is titled China Wielding the Economic Clout, and I'll take you through the various slides and also the paper, that the work that I have done. I've had the opportunity to visit China a number of times, and interact as part of the External Affairs Minister's delegations, as also as Joint Secretary in the Ministry of Textiles, when we had a lot of collaboration with regard to cotton policies. 2018 marks the 40th anniversary of China's reform and opening up policy. Four decades of reform have transformed China from one of the poorest countries to now the second largest economy in the world. And it accounts for one-third of global growth. 800 million people have been lifted out of poverty. 80 crore people have been lifted out of poverty. And the country has achieved middle-income status. A few provinces of China have achieved advanced economy income levels. Today, China's expanding footprint is visible from Asia to the Pacific to Africa and beyond through the Belt and Road Initiative and several infrastructure projects. As China increasingly approaches the world stage, President Xi Jinping, in a speech to mark 40 years of market reforms in December 2018, said that China's development does not pose a threat to any country. No matter how far China develops, it will never seek hegemony. Further, Xi Jinping said that China is committed to the multilateral trading system and opening up of its economy, saying that no one is in a position to dictate to the Chinese people what should or should not be done. The speech reiterated the distinctiveness and the ideological correctness of China's economic path. President Xi Jinping's thoughts have been enshrined into the Communist Party Charter and were elaborated in his 3.5-hour speech at the 19th Communist Party National Congress held in October 2017. Seated next to him were two of his predecessors, Presidents Jiang Zemin and Hu Jintao. The October Communist Party National Congress declared China's entry into a new era and laid out a strategic vision for the great modern socialist country by the mid-21st century. China's developmental challenge has evolved from meeting people's basic needs to their ever-growing needs for a better life, as it sought to transform the economy from high speed to high quality growth. There are three critical battles that the Chinese have identified to fight. One is to fight financial risk. The second is to eliminate absolute poverty. And the third is to tackle environmental pollution. There have been critics internally in the Communist Party. There has been voices on how the roadmap that they should follow. And one of the president's key aides, Wang Qishan, a member of the 7-member Politburo Standing Committee, said that indiscriminate separation of the party and government affairs has led to the weakening of the party's leading role. Wang Qishan said, "Upholding the Communist Party's leading role is the paramount political principle for contemporary China. The 19th Communist Party National Congress has called for strengthening the party's role in every aspect of public life. The Chinese authorities have implemented major institutional restructuring to implement the reform agenda. Communist Party central committees in key areas of structural reforms have been formed. The committees have been given a leading role in policy making and oversight. The newly established Financial Stability and Development Committee will be responsible for interagency coordination, merging the banking and insurance regulators, and restructuring the financial regulatory framework. New government agencies have been set up for international aid and market regulation. China is an important contributor to global growth and trade, and increasingly an interconnected participant in the global financial markets. It's also a major international creditor with the Belt and Road Initiative. The Belt and Road Initiative has great potential for China and the participating countries by filling large and long-standing infrastructure gaps in partner countries, boosting their growth prospects, strengthening global supply chains, and increasing employment. There are concerns about lack of transparency over contracts, lack of openness in procurement, and debt sustainability of partner countries. Amidst the competing claims and vision for global leadership, the United States has been a strong critic of China's policies. At the November 2017 Pacific Summit at Port Moresby, the Vice President of the United States, Michael Pence, said that the United States, a democracy, is a better partner than authoritarian China. Know that United States offers a better option. We don't drown our partners in a sea of debt. We don't coerce, compromise your independence. We don't offer a constricting belt or a one-way road. When you partner with us, we partner with you, and we all prosper. That was the vision that Vice President Pence stated. On additional tariffs of about $250 billion that the United States has imposed on Chinese goods, Vice President Pence said the United States will not change course unless China changes its ways. China has been reiterating in multiple fora that its international infrastructure drive is a win-win progress, and it is not designed to serve any hidden political agenda, nor targeted against anyone, and it does not exclude anyone. How is the Chinese economy looking in 2018? When you wish to play a global role of this magnitude, you need a very strong economy. 2018 has marked the appointment of Yi Gang as the governor of the People's Bank of China. His illustrious predecessor, Zhao Xiaochuan, widely known as China's most able technocrat, retired after 17 years in office. The appointment of Dr. Yi Gang indicates a commitment to continue with Zhao Xiaochuan's legacy of liberal-minded reforms. That said, a politician, Guo Shu King, has been appointed as the party secretary of the People's Bank of China. This is the first time that there is a political and a technical element of the role in the People's Bank of China that has been split up. In his speech to commemorate the 40th anniversary of China's economic reform and the 70th anniversary of the People's Bank of China, Governor Yi Gang said that financial adjustment and macroeconomic prudential management framework in China have improved. The PBC has resolved the high-risk financial holding groups, restored financial order, and conducted a special program for addressing internet-based financial risks. There has also been a deepening of the financial sector reforms. There are three major banks that have been identified, which is the China Development Bank, the Export-Import Bank of China, and the Agricultural Development Bank, which have been positioned as developmental financial institutions with strengthened capital base and remarkably improved governance structures. Further, China has promoted reforms of the market-based interests and exchange rates. Today, the renminbi has been internationalized on a market-oriented basis, and it ranks fifth worldwide as a global currency of payment, and it accounts for about 2.12% of the global markets. The RMB reserves that have been held by various countries stand at $194 billion, and over 60 foreign central banks and monetary authorities have included the RMB in their foreign exchange reserves. China has also focused on opening up the financial sector and has made headway in establishing a rules-based financial sector with the enactment of the banking and insurance laws. In terms of the economic developments, you can see from this slide that there is stronger growth and slower rebalancing. The year-on-year growth has been 6.7 to 6.9%. It is witnessing low inflation at 2%. Corporate profits are being witnessed. Reduced capital outflow pressures, otherwise there was a lot of capital outflow from China that was happening in the years 2016 and 17. And their foreign exchange reserves stand at $3.1 trillion, which is 260% of the import cover. A growth rebalancing has been attempted to service sectors from the infrastructure sectors. That is, they wish to promote now information technology, health, and pharmaceutical sectors. And there has been a continued reduction in coal, steel, as also the housing inventories. China has also responded to, there have been a lot of trade tensions with the United States, and how has China responded to the trade tensions? China has responded to the trade tensions by lowering of entry barriers for financial services and autos, and import tariffs on a wide range of consumer goods, shortening the negative list on foreign investments, and there has been a direct impact on tariffs announced to date that appears to be quite limited. In fact, although $250 billion of tariffs have been imposed by the United States, in terms of exports, that kind of slowdown that was to be expected is yet to be felt. However, this impact can be amplified with further rounds of retaliation through financial and investment channels. Amongst the major opening up areas, there are plans to open up the financial services to foreign investment, including raising the foreign ownership cap to 51% and removing the cap in about 3 years' time. Manufacturing sector has been comprehensively opened to foreign competitors, and import tariffs have been cut from 17.3% to 7.7% on a selection of consumer goods, including food, health, medicines, clothes and shoes. So this is a huge change in terms of trade tensions, and this was the manner in which China has responded to tariffs being imposed on their various export products. How is China wielding the economic clout? President Xi Jinping has indicated that China has entered a new era under his leadership, and it seeks to secure a decisive victory in building moderately prosperous society in all respects and strive for the greatest success of socialism with Chinese characteristics in a new era, an era that sees China moving to center stage. The policy push has been opening up will bring progress, while those who are closed down will inevitably lag behind. There are some policy contradictions, too, in that China has launched the Made in 2025 program, with Chinese firms expected to control domestic markets by as much as 80% by 2025. China seeks to shape an international order and norms and institutions where it forcefully asserts its presence on the global stage. It wishes to construct international playgrounds, and China's influence on these international organizations is at an all-time high. As you can see from the slide, in the International Monetary Fund, it currently has a voting right of 6.09%. On the Asian Development Bank, it is at 5.5% and is the third largest member in both these institutions. Further, China has joined as a member in the African Development Bank, the Caribbean Development Bank, the Inter-American Development Bank, and the European Bank for Reconstruction and Development. Thereby, the footprint of Chinese voice is being felt across all the international developmental institutions in the world. American magazines have been highly critical. The Foreign Affairs says that China is an illiberal state seeking leadership in a liberal world order. That said, many countries have accepted the Chinese leadership, as can be seen from the Belt and Road Initiative and the other big initiative, that is the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, where China votes about 26% on the AIIB. Let me take you to the Belt and Road Initiative. This is one of the most massive infrastructure projects that has been taken up in many years in the globe, and the single biggest investment that the Chinese have planned is the Belt and Road Initiative, which is a massive project involving funding and construction of a system of roads, railways, oil and natural gas pipelines, fiber optics and communication systems, ports and airports. The Belt and Road Initiative will create new norms of connectedness across much of Central Asia and also Europe, and lead to greater interdependence and enhanced growth of states in these areas. China has defined the BRI as a win-win situation through the creation of an economic system that's mutually beneficial for all participants. As of August 2018, 70 countries have signed contracts with China for projects related to the BRI.
China has enshrined the BRI in its constitution, a signal that the Communist Party views it more than a regular foreign policy initiative. In implementing the BRI projects, China has taken up more than 900 projects. 80% of these are contracted to Chinese firms. Chinese state-owned enterprises are currently running 76 ports in 34 countries, including Pakistan, Sri Lanka, and Greece. Chinese state-owned enterprises have made a number of high-risk investments in strategic ports, railway track construction, road construction projects for the next wave of global economic leadership. In fact, China's BRI initiative has created a deep interdependence across Europe and also Central Asia. The nearest that comes to this kind of a vision is the Marshall Plan, which created a system of deep and complex interdependence between the United States and Europe, and that is the closest analog to the BRI in terms of promoting structural power. China is pursuing a number of free trade agreements and as part of the long-term multilateral approach to be included in the institutional infrastructure of the BRI. The first is the Sino-Swiss Free Trade Agreement. The second is the Sino-Polish Comprehensive Strategic Partnership. The third is the Chinese partnership with these SREB countries, which are Czech Republic, Bulgaria, Slovakia, and Poland. And fourth is China's cooperation with the Central and East European countries, which is 16 plus 1 framework. So let me take you to the first one, the Sino-Swiss agreement, which might be considered a benchmark, in fact, a gold standard in the context of the BRI. The Swiss government's position has been include as many partners into the free trade agreement that benefits of the FTA will increase. The BRI gives China the narrative to collapse several bilateral free trade agreements into multilateral trade agreements to maximize welfare benefits. It's likely that in the coming years, the Swiss trade with Kazakhstan will improve because of the Belt and Road Initiative. Similarly, the Sino-Polish Comprehensive Strategic Partnership of 2016 and the Polish decision to join the AIIB have significant geopolitical consequences. Further, the SREB countries have signed a comprehensive strategic partnership with China during President Xi Jinping's visit to Warsaw in 2016. And China's cooperation with the Central and East European countries, the CEEC, is within the framework of the G16 plus 1, is being spoken of by Chinese scholars as restoration of the European civilization. So there is a China, Central Asia, West Asia corridor which is connecting China-Kazakhstan railways to Uzbekistan, Turkmenistan, and Iran. The involvement of the five Central Asian republics in the BRI is very profitable by ensuring economic and political benefits, with trade increasing to $34 billion by 2015. And China is financing huge energy sector projects in Turkmenistan and Kazakhstan. The Central Asian pivot of the modern Silk Road is Kazakhstan. President Nazarbayev has highlighted the complementarity between the BRI and the Kazakhstan's economic policy, the Bright Road, with both aiming to create transport infrastructures integrated with big international railways and roads. The Economist recently has said that if not a debt trap, Chinese investments in infrastructure are often a diplomatic one. The Economist cites the Malaysian BRI of East Coast Rail Link, which costs more than $20 billion, financed entirely by Chinese loans and constructed by Chinese workers, has resulted in Malaysian debt shooting up. The Center for Global Development has listed 23 countries involved in BRI at significant debt distress. These include Pakistan, which is in fact facing a balance of payments crisis, as also Myanmar, Sri Lanka, and Maldives. The U.S. President, Donald Trump, has said China is out to bankrupt weak governments, to erode sovereignty and dictate terms, and he's called it debt trap diplomacy. Turning to Africa, 2018, the Beijing organized a forum summit on China-Africa cooperation. And there are 8 major initiatives for collaboration, and the quantum of money that China is financing Africa is $60 billion. It's a huge amount of money that China has invested in Africa. Of these, the grants, interest-free loans are $15 billion, credit loans are $20 billion. There's a special fund for development financing, which is $10 billion, and a special fund for financing African imports, which stands at $5 billion. And the synergy between the BRI and the African Union agenda of 2063 has been worked. The aim is to build a strong China-Africa community with a shared future. Let me take you to the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank. It's a major diplomatic success for China to set up the world's first multilateral development bank since 1991. It has 97 member countries. It's working hard to make the AIIB work and have several countries where it has its international presence. Another major initiative of China, which shows its clout on the world economy, is the Hangzhou G20 Summit of 2016. It's a major global leadership initiative of China to host the G20 Leaders Summit meeting in Hangzhou, and it has also gained membership of this very elite Paris Club, which handles debt restructuring of major countries, and there has been a major quota increase in the IMF. The G20 summit at Hangzhou is a very comprehensive one in that the G20 Digital Cooperation Initiative was signed by the global leaders. It's important to understand how China controls the internet. And China has called for a multilateral approach to governing cyberspace, with the United Nations taking a leadership role in building international consensus on rules. A UN-based multilateral approach has the benefit of prioritizing the interests of governments over technology companies, and it would allow China to mobilize votes of developing countries, many of whom would like to control the internet and the free flow of information. At the World Internet Conference in Wuhan in 2017, the Apple CEO Tim Cook said that Apple shares China's vision for developing a digital economy of openness and shared benefits. Many have construed this statement of Apple as Apple's willingness to play by Beijing's rules. China has endeavored to control the world's digital infrastructure, promoting its vision of a closed internet. China has said countries should be allowed to choose their own path of cyber development, model of cyber regulation, and internet public policies. Over the past 5 years, controls have been tightened on websites and social media. In March 2017, Chinese government told Tencent, the second largest of Chinese digital giants, to shut down websites which they have hosted, included discussions on history, international relations, and military. Several virtual private networks used by Chinese business entrepreneurs and academics have been directed to be blocked. Even American companies have complied with these new rules. Apple has removed hundreds of programs from its software that enable deeper penetration behind the great firewall. China has announced regulations to reduce online anonymity and made organizers of online forums personally accountable for contributions of their members. There's also a digital Silk Road being built as part of the Belt and Road Initiative, which comprises of fiber optic cables, mobile networks, satellite relay stations, data centers, and smart cities. These activities are being led by Chinese companies and not by government. Alibaba has acquired a Pakistan e-commerce company called Daraz and launched a digital free trade zone with the support of Malaysian and Thai governments, which will ease customs checks and promote MSME exports from Malaysia and Thailand to China. Alibaba has been providing surveillance mapping, cloud storage, data analysis services in Ethiopia, Nigeria, Laos, Sri Lanka, Sudan, and Turkey. The spread of Chinese companies in terms of the Digital Silk Road is quite vast. Let me conclude by saying that China seeks to play a greater leadership role to compensate for the United States' retreat. And the United States-China bipolar world order faces a period of recurring trade tensions and fierce competition. While it is not the last word is yet to be said in terms of the trade tensions, we await to see how escalation would take place or whether talks would be successful in the light of President Trump's recent statement that during the next G20 summit in Japan, which is next week, there would be a long discussion between him and the President of China. So we await to see how these trade tensions would unfold. So let me thank you, sir, for chairing this session and thank all of you for your patience. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Srinivas. That was a good coverage of the China's economy and what role that China seeks to play in the world order. I'll just make a few remarks which I have observed during this talk as well as the paper per se. First one is the statement by Mr. Xi Jinping, which was quoted, like, China's development does not pose a threat to any country. No matter how far China develops, it will never seek hegemony. Now, there is one more counter statement to this by Chou Enlai a long time back. Please don't go by what we say. Please observe what we do. So that is something we'll have to wait and watch. That actually substantiates Srinivas' statement that the jury is still out on how China wants to play this role in the future. The second one is on the, Wang Qishan is not a state Politburo Standing Committee member because he's the vice president at this point in time without any kind of party affiliations. He has come in basically on the instance of Mr. Xi Jinping and he draws his power from Xi Jinping per se. The BRI is a very contentious issue as of now. There are certain countries which vouch for it. There are certain countries which have raised observations on it. It is still, again, an ongoing project. Lot many people say that the projects are not economically viable. Some people say it is a debt trap. Some people say it's a diplomacy trap. And some of the countries which are affected by this say that it is not China's mistake, but we haven't actually done due diligence in all these contacts, etc. It is a mixed bag at this point in time. We'll have to wait and see as to how it pans out. Combined with this, if you look at the second Belt and Road Forum that was held in April this year in China, there has been a certain amount of accommodation that has been seen in the statement that have been made. Basically, in terms of accommodating the concerns which were expressed and the pushbacks that were seen for the BRI projects, there was a certain amount of accommodation that came up during the talks by Mr. Xi Jinping and others. But it remains to be seen as to how these are actually practically being implemented. The party getting a role in all the economic kind of institutions, during Mao Zedong's time, this was very common, that every commercial entity had a party cell in the commercial entity. That was dismantled over a period of time by Mr. Deng Xiaoping, Mr. Hu Jintao, Mr. Jiang Zemin, Hu Jintao, and till Hu Jintao. During Xi Jinping's tenure, all these party cells seem to be coming back again. There is again a mixed kind of a feeling in this. Some people in the corporate sector in China say that no, it doesn't matter. They don't interfere in our affairs. But some people seem to say parties' control is increasing on the commercial establishments. Whether they are international, multinational ones or the domestic ones, still you find a party presence in all these commercial establishments. I had discussed this earlier with Mr. Srinivas in my office some time back, that the way the UN is panning out, the day may not be very far away when it becomes fully tradable at some point in time. So that is something we all need to wait and watch as to the moment that comes up, you will find the international monetary system undergoing a vast change and there will be a split between whether the reserve should be held in dollars or in yuans or whatever. So that is something we need to wait and watch. The figures of inflation and unemployment rate, I have been watching this for the last about 18 odd years continuously. And somehow or the other, the figures remain almost the same. You can go back in the National Bureau of Statistics, they've given number of years statistics, if you take it out, you will find the unemployment rates will vary between 4.3 and 4.9, and the inflation rates will vary between 1.9 to 3. somehow or the other, this remains a constant. So I leave it for your judgment to see and read through this as to where this particular thing stands. As far as foreign exchange is concerned, there are two things that we need to keep in mind. When Mr. Xi Jinping came to power, the foreign exchange reserves were $3.95 trillion. Now the foreign exchange reserves have been reduced to $3.1 billion. So there has been a reduction in the foreign exchange reserves during the last 5 years to the tune of $850 billion, which is not a very small sum. Basically, it happened because of two things. One is, in 2015, when the Shanghai Stock Exchange crashed, the investors started taking the money out. In 6 months' time, China lost about $600 billion. By the time they stabilized the market, they lost about $600 billion. The remainder is likely to have been invested in the One Belt, One Road initiative projects. So that is how this money has been generally been accounted for. The other thing is that even though China has reduced the entry barriers in financial services, etc., the non-tariff barriers are the ones that we need to be worried about. The regulatory mechanisms, if you want to say export, say anything for that matter, soya beans for that matter, to China, all across the country there is not one regulation. Every province has got a different regulation. Because of that, the countries wanting to make an entry into China face a lot of difficulties. So the non-tariff barriers and the regulatory procedures are something that we need to look into to overcome this particular thing. The impact of trade dispute, again, the jury is out, as he said. The problem is that we don't know which way it is going to go. But going purely by the numbers of tariffs, it will be the Chinese who will lose. Because Chinese export $170 billion worth of goods to US, and Americans import almost $550 billion worth of goods. So if America can impose tariffs on $550 billion, China can only retaliate with tariffs on $170 billion. Going by sheer numbers, it will be in favor of US and not in favor of China. Having said that, even though the tariffs have been imposed, till today, there has been no distinct sign that Chinese are suffering or the trade dispute deficit is reducing. That is not visible as yet. We'll have to wait and see further to see as to how this is going to play out. Also, to cater for this tariff, etc., because of the tariff dispute and other disputes that are going on between US and China, a lot of companies are wanting to move out of China. There was a study which was done by, I think, Rhodium Group, which talked about 2,200 companies they reached out to, out of which 46% said that they want to move out of China. And if you cater for that, Chinese have come out with a new investment law. And the new investment law basically tries to level the playing field between the domestic companies and the foreign companies. So they are trying to reach out to companies to give some softs so that they don't move out of China. The domestic consumption issue and the MIC 2025, this is something we need to understand in the correct context. The domestic consumption China sought to increase the moment the international financial crisis took place in 2008. It was an export-oriented economy, and the moment the financial crisis took place, their economy was getting hit. So they needed to increase the domestic consumption. The problem is, the domestic consumption has not increased to the extent that they want to do it. So therefore, they are having a problem of, basically what happens, in a society, if the middle class is larger, you will find the domestic consumption going up. And actually, the middle class has not grown so well in China, so they are finding it a problem. The second thing is the Made in China 2025. Made in China 2025 came up because of two things. One, China was actually a manual labor oriented economy in the sense that large quantity of manual labor was used to produce goods. Then you have a curve which will taper off at some point in time because you can't keep on putting manpower into it. They also suffered because of the age factor. They also suffered because of lack of skills factor. As a result, they have to scale up the production. How do you scale up the production? You increase the production, automate it. You go for the Industry 4.0, which Germany brought out, and they drew it from there and made MIC 2025, which actually goes to the fourth level of manufacturing. That is what they are trying to do. On the Belt and Road Initiative, there have been a lot of murmurs in China too. Why are we spending our money to create projects somewhere else, which will probably may or may not give us returns? Even if they give returns, it is going to have a long gestation period. So there have been a lot of murmurs within China too. But that is something that has not come out in a very big way, and so we'll have to wait and watch as to how this plays out. The G16 plus one, there are again mixed views on this. Even within the European Union, some of the countries feel the 16 plus 1 is a concept which China has brought in basically to create a rift within the European Union. Because the 16 plus 1 is basically consisting of 16 countries which are in East Europe. So that is something that is creating a little bit of issue within the European Union. The Malaysian project has already been given back to the Chinese with reduced length in the tracks as well as reduced cost factor. The Hangzhou one is in 2017, not 16. Because it happened after the Wuhan summit. Oh, this is the other one. Okay. Yeah, that's fine. China again has got, what we need to look at China now today, what he talked about, the digital Silk Road, etc. Digital Silk Road is actually going to be an important thing that we all need to watch. And the reason for that is, digital Silk Road is all about data. And data is going to rule the world in future. So if you want to watch as to how this is going to develop, we need to closely watch the digital Silk Road that is coming up and the projects that are being taken along the using this digital Silk Road. Lastly, only two points I would like to say. One is, in the internet, control is one thing which Mr. Srinivas talked about. The other thing that we all need to now look at is the 5G regulations that are going to come up. Now, that is creating a lot of issues within the 3GPP mechanism as to what regulations have to come up as far as the 5G is concerned. Now, that is going to be the future, and that is going to be an important thing that we all need to watch. One point that we need to, again, last point I would like to say, is that, like you have SWIFT for transferring money. Chinese have got their own system. So, that is another system that they are trying to create as an alternative system to the normal existing financial system. So, if you put all this together in one, what picture do we get? We get exactly what he was trying to say, that Chinese are trying to do something to the world's economic system and they are trying to actually increase their influence in this particular field. Having said that, now I'll open the floor for questions. How much time do we have? 15 to 20 minutes. Right. We'll have to.
Good afternoon. My question is with regard to the FTAs. My name is Srinivasan. I am from the Indian alkali industry. I'm the Secretary General. You have touched upon various FTAs, but you have not mentioned anything about the significance and the role that China had to play in the ongoing RCEP negotiations, which is touted as one of the mega trade agreements which could have a large bearing on international trade.
Thank you, sir. I'm Sanjeev Shivastav. I'm a researcher on foreign policy issues. I'm currently teaching at University of Delhi. My question would be regarding the implications of the BRI. Could you focus on what are its implications for the rest of the world? Because the way they are expanding and the way they are building the influence, their economic clout, whether they will be succeeding in somewhat substantially changing the entire rules of the world or not, how sustainable it will be, that is also a question. And another question is that whether it will, this entire building of the economic clout has caused some internal disruptions in China also or not, whether what kind of changes within their system has been brought in or automatically has come in because of this kind of growing economic clout of China. So these are two questions I have. Thank you.
Yeah, my name is Sarjit Dudeja. Sir, I want to know about this China. They are not using usual like Facebook or Google or other things. They have their own. This way they are trying to disrupt the other countries like USA and other. So this way they can collapse the economy of other country, one thing. And they can protect themselves. Nobody can impeach their system. Second thing is your data is a mine. The way they are trying to hack and the data, they can make a nuisance for other country. Second thing, I want to know whether the economic clout is have some implication in political clout also, like in their implication in Nepal, Pakistan, and other parts of the world.
RCEP negotiations are currently going on, and they're largely through the ASEAN network. Currently, Singapore holds the chair of ASEAN. The next round of negotiations will start in the coming months. The RCEP negotiations offer fascinating prospects in terms of Southeast Asian collaboration, and they fit in very much into India's Act East policy. In fact, yesterday I was in Singapore and a lot of policy makers were talking about the benefits of India's Act East policy in terms of Indian presence, not only in employment opportunities, student opportunities, also in terms of trade opportunities and investment opportunities. These were some things that were being felt. The dean of the Lee Kuan Yew School of Public Policy was mentioning that almost 20% of the students in Singapore are from India. So there's been a substantial increase. So in terms of trade opportunities, investment opportunities, as also in terms of economic cooperation, the RCEP is likely to be a huge win-win situation and create a more integrated Southeast Asian market. And it fits in very much with our Act East policy that we're looking at. The second question on the implications of BRI. The BRI is trying to create transnational economic corridors. In that you have a corridor that goes from Central Asian Republics, China, linking Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, Turkmenistan, then Tajikistan, and all the way up to Azerbaijan, and connecting the entire gas fields of Azerbaijan to the Chinese corridors. It is not a day that is far off when a train can actually ply from Beijing all the way to Azerbaijan. So that is the kind of transnational economic corridors in terms of railways and roadways that are being linked. Similarly, a day is not far off when Geneva could perhaps be linked by roads and trains to Beijing. That is what is happening. And bilateral free trade agreements do have their own benefits. But when you start building transnational economic corridors, multilateral economic agreements have to shape up. And several of the Central Asian republics or the G16 East European countries which are there, which are quite fragile economies like Bulgaria, Romania, and these coming under the huge benefits of the BRI with massive investment coming in, growth spurts are likely to be seen in these countries. So that is why you have a bright road which is similar to a Belt and Road. So President Nazarbayev is constructing what is called a bright road in Kazakhstan as compared to a Belt and Road by integrating it into the BRI. So right now, most countries would like to see it as investments coming in. But there are also concerns in that there is going to be huge increases in debt because it is not a free grant kind of a project. With this kind of increase in debt, how is sustainability going to happen? And the April 2019 BRI summit, as the chairman has pointed out, China did yield some ground and there was a pushback or kind of phasing out of BRI projects. A larger part of it, when you compare China's bilateral financing through BRI vis-a-vis the multilateral financing through the AIIB, you will find that the BRI projects at almost $650 billion far outnumber what they're doing it through multilateral banks. So one can safely say that China's bilateral economic clout is surely on the rise with the BRI. It is likely to create employment opportunities, and if countries can stave off debt distress and convert these projects into growth opportunities, it will be a win-win for most of the borrowing countries. Then we have with regard to their own websites. Yes, they do run their own websites. There is this important point about the 5G dominance, and scholars have read about how the fifth generation mobile networks, particularly this Huawei, you know, Huawei, which is a colossal player in the global race for 5G dominance. And it is a Chinese company, and it's currently boasting about 28% of the global market for telecom equipment. And it is signing a huge number of contracts, both in Europe as well as in the Americas, and they're looking for major dominance in terms of the Digital Silk Road too. Of course, there have been challenges, like the Huawei's vice president has been recently arrested in Canada on grounds of certain intellectual property rights issues at a request from the United States. And that has snowballed into some of the Canadians being arrested in China as a countermeasure. And definitely they're looking at a closed internet, and looking at dominance in terms of the 5G spectrum network that is coming in.
Any more questions?
Good afternoon, sir. Thank you very much for the paper. In terms of the US-China trade war, how much do you think that India is to benefit from the tensions between these two large economies? Also, my question mostly deflects towards the FDI, and how much do you think the foreign direct investment landscape in India can nourish itself from this tension world over? Thank you.
For Indian exports to benefit, the exports have to be priced cheaper than your competing country. So India's major export strength in terms of engineering exports, in terms of textile exports, in terms of which are the other ones? Chemicals, pharmaceuticals. So these areas, we have to be more competitive. Simultaneously, there has been recently a notification that the United States has withdrawn GSP preferences to India. So in terms of India's own exports, while we have some optimistic scenario that, okay, if China's exports in some of the sectors are going to be hit, we may become more competitive. It depends on how our companies price and compete in the global markets. It could easily be that textile exports, instead of coming to or export orders coming to India, may actually go to Bangladesh or Vietnam, Laos, PDR, and Cambodia. So it's a very competitive market, and unless you compete with both quality as also in pricing, the kind of trade shift towards India cannot materialize. Anything more? Does that clarify your question?
Partially.
See, there is no major effect as yet to be seen. You know, trade has not been disrupted to that magnitude. And the U.S. is saying that we are going to open up talks. So unless there is some clarity whether these are long-term trade barriers, then we will have an impact. 1 month slowing down will not shift orders away. It has to be more long-term, say 5 years you're going to be under sanctions, then orders will shift away.
Sir, are you satisfied with the India's stand on BRI? Obviously, we have related it with our sovereignty issues with the Jammu in Kashmir. So, also, we have very much a lot of concerns, what Americans call the predatory economics. So you are saying, I understand that countries are getting benefited from a lot of projects, bilateral investment by China. But how should we respond to it? I mean, there are some proposals like, for example, India, Japan, and some other countries like United States, they're trying to come up with the Asia-Africa growth corridor. And U.S. Has been trying and again expressing their concerns, like what you have mentioned about Pence's speech in 2017. So in that regard, how should we respond, how the international community should respond to the BRI initiative? Though I understand that there are a lot of benefits for a lot of countries.
Why did China have to put investments outside its own borders? That is something you need to understand. In that it was an economy that was overheating. It was growing so fast, 9.5%, 10%, 11%, 12%, 13%. The growth rate was so high. And there were global imbalances growing in that the United States was importing too much and China was exporting too much. So there was tremendous pressure that a certain level of global rebalancing be achieved. To achieve global rebalancing, they had to put investments in other countries. They had to send their own capital from investing within their own country to other countries. So one of the four initiatives that they identified as part of the global rebalancing was the Belt and Road Initiative. There were, of course, others like Make in China 2025. There was the AIB, which is financing projects. But one of the big ones was the BRI. And unfortunately, there was also the Shanghai Stock Exchange collapse, which resulted in massive capital outflows. And that partially slowed down the kind of investments that they were putting into BRI. But global rebalancing, to an extent, has to be achieved, and there are still a lot of concerns about how correctly the RMB is being valued. So one of the big things was that the RMB, the yuan should move in both directions, and in that today the RMB is almost 7 yuan per dollar, 6.7 or 6.9 per dollar, that is what it is currently. I do remember there was a period when it was 4 yuan per dollar for a number of years. It was a fixed currency where no movement was permissible. That's why they kept on accumulating reserves and it went up to 3.5 trillion US dollars. With the RMB appreciating against the dollar, depreciating against the dollar, it has become more viable for them to, it makes space for more export. That's why the tariffs had to come in, that the imbalances were once again creeping up. It remains to be seen how much the BRI will take off and how it will end up. In that transnational economic corridors is a very ambitious vision, and several projects have been, 900 projects have been sanctioned. Countries are facing debt distress. It's a long-term vision, and it will have definitely increased infrastructure in many countries.
Just clarify one point. China is such a strong economy, military and everything. Why they are not transparent in the data or in system?
Sorry?
Why are they not transparent? Why they don't disclose their everything in a...
You see, they are more transparent than what they were before. In terms of even capital controls, they have brought down the number of capital controls. But it is a one-party state. There is a political system that is in place, and they're trying to provide leadership to a world economic order at this point of time.
Can I ask just one small question? So in view of the fact you've always, throughout your talk, talked about the mega infrastructure being created, which is what BRI is. India, in a smaller scale, has been going in for this international transport corridor, multimodal. And I understand that last year there were some trial runs, and some people told me that they were not viable. In that context, I wanted to know, how will these Chinese investments prove viable for them, and what about our own also?
Some of the big corridors that we have constructed are these in the northeast, which linked Myanmar and Thailand with India, and those were the Tamu Kalamyo corridor that was built at that point of time. It was one of the large corridors that we have built. Economic corridors do have benefits of their own. But the project has to be sustainable and viable at the end of it. Right now, construction is going on, and one has to see viability over a longer period of time.
Sir, I am architect Amar Puri. My question relates to CPAC and Pakistan. There are in fact two questions. One, the type of social and economic stress it is creating in Pakistan. Can you please tell us something about that? Second, its security and defense implications for India. Thank you.
Well, right now, Pakistan has approached the International Monetary Fund for a 13th program.
Yes.
For a 13th IMF program, and we'll have to see how the conditionalities for this 13th IMF program will be drawn up, and the extent of financing is quite massive. I'm told it's in the from the IMF press statements, it is in the range of about $8 billion to $10 billion. They have also approached the World Bank for another $8 billion package. So huge amount of borrowing is taking place, and apparently there is a certain level of debt stress that the economy, Pakistan economy, is facing. And the IMF program will try to tighten the belt, cut fiscal expenditures, and restore some level of fiscal balancing. So the program has just started, and we'll have to wait and see how tight the conditionality will be terms of Pakistan from the Bretton Woods institutions. In fact, the Americans have also said that we will not finance a package where you will refund your loans to China. If you're borrowing money from IMF and World Bank, you cannot use this money to refinance your loans which you have taken from China. So the program contours are being drawn up. They have not been, it's only the initial consultations between the Pakistani authorities and the Bretton Woods institutions that have taken place, and certain broad willingness has been expressed. So apparently CPEC is $118 billion. Such a massive borrowing is not viable for any country.
Its implications for India?
Implications of CPEC for
Security
India?
Security and defense implications of CPEC?
No, this paper is only about the economic strength, you see. I have not studied the... I have no expertise on these security issues.
Any other questions? Right. Let me then add a little more to what Mr. Srinivas has already said on the questions. One is on the RCEP and the issues related to it. It was already in the media, I'm sure many of you would have read it, that, you know, we are looking at two things. One is the goods trade, the other one is the services. So the problem is coming up in negotiating these two together. Most of the countries would like to go for goods trade, but then the services is something that we need to actually negotiate and get onto it. That is the basic thing that has come up. The second thing about the implications of BRA for the rest of the world, again, it's a work in progress. We need to wait and see. Most of the projects, if you analyze them individually, they're not economically viable. So we need to wait and see as to how it plays out in the long run to see as to whether it benefits the countries or whether it benefits China or doesn't benefit both. It could happen whichever way it goes. The third thing on the Facebook, Google, etc., they have their own system of running the systems inside that country. You go to China today, you can't operate Google, you can't operate WhatsApp, but they have their own systems of Paitu running it very well, and instead of Google Map, they are using maps used by Paitu, which they say is much better as far as China is concerned. So they have their own system. So anybody can create a system. And what stopped us from creating a system? We can also create a system when it is required. So that is the way to see this. The economic clout revealing into the political clout, in some places you get to see it. Like Nepal is one place you mentioned. Earlier, Maldives, you could quote Maldives to some extent. To some extent you can quote Sri Lanka. Zimbabwe for that matter. In a number of countries it was seen, but you can't prove anything with that. The thing is that they got economic clout, they have a bilateral relationship. How it pans out is something that for both the countries to look into and decide on that. India's benefit from the trade dispute, I think, was your question. It has benefited us in some form, in the sense that the Chinese have agreed to import more from us in terms of sugar, in terms of rapeseed oil, in terms of soya beans, and other things. But again, the regulatory factors which I mentioned to you earlier come into play. So we need to wait and see as to how much we are able to export. That is one. The second thing is what I told you about shifting of the manufacturing from China to other countries. In that study, it was found that Vietnam was number one in priority for shifting. Indonesia was priority two for shifting. India was priority three for shifting. That is also basically because of your supply chains. If it is closer to China, it is easier for them to shift and the supply chains are shorter. So if you shift it far away, then the supply chains have to stretch to that particular level. So you need to consider all this and see that. Third is the ease of business. How you allow them to enter, how you regulatory mechanisms, how you make it easier. We have come 66 places up. We need to come probably a little more. So if, and last point is what he said. You have to be price competitive. If you're not price competitive, why would people come here? So these are the things that we need to keep in mind when we decide and work on how much of that we can attract into India. And the fourth thing is about the north-south corridor, which you talked about. Corridors, not only one corridor. You talked about the Kaladan multimodal project is still going in some form. The corridor which Mr. Srinivas said is already working. The Chabahar port has started working in some form. So the issue is, these are all, again, ongoing projects. Some of them may be for strategic purposes, some of them may be for economic purposes. And so you'll have to see both in the different lights. The lastly, on the CPEC, on the social economic stress in Pakistan, we have not come for any, no reports have come up so far. There have been certain amount of protests in Balochistan that the projects are not going there. There have been some protests in Sindh saying that too many Chinese have come into this place. So, not many Pakistan. Those things are there. But has it reached some kind of a critical mass? That is a question that we need to wait and watch. At the moment, the critical mass is not there. As far as security and defense implications are concerned, I don't see a major security and defense implication on this. The road going through, let it go through. How does it help you? Unless you are expecting the Chinese troops to come in and fight from Pakistan. Now, that is a thing which is a little far-fetched. It is... A lot of people have returned, troops have come in, this thing, that thing, etc., etc. If you look through that, you will find that most of them are for protection of these projects. Gwadar, if it comes into a naval base, yes, it will have some implications. I am sure our Navy and other people have already noticed it and taken care of the necessary implications. I don't see a major security implication coming up on this particular thing. All that remains for me to say is to thank Mr. Srinivas for a good talk and for participants for joining the discussion in a very active manner. Thank you very much.
I'm very, very thankful to Shri V. Srinivas and also General Narasimhan for chairing the session. And I'm thankful to all members of the audience as well. And tea is waiting outside. We'll carry on the discussion over the tea. Okay.